This morning and say a quick hello.
A little sleep.
Standing over here, we were just talking about doing something different. There's a book called Change is Good, You Go First. Change is good, you go first. I'll get behind you. But it's so true, no matter what you're going through in your life, you have to let God take control. I think it would be cool, Bruce, if we got some little steering wheels that didn't work. And anytime we really felt the need, the urge to drive, and things just weren't going our way, we just maybe take that fake steering wheel, because God's got the wheel. We don't. So let's always remember that. And as we sing this song, let's really just quiet our minds and open our hearts to this moment right here and let the words wash over us.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves, when no my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Let's join our voices.
Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign will be our guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail, and you won't start now. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. So will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
As we sing this, let's really think about what it means to us right now, where we stand.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence.
We're gonna sing that again.
Spirit, trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name.
We need you, Lord.
And keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine.
This morning we're going to do something a little bit different, so don't sit down. We're going to invite you to remain standing as Michelle Transu, our lay reader this morning, comes and shares God's word with us.
You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and mother so that you may live long in the land of the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled in fear. If you'll join me now, let us pray. We pray, O Lord, this morning that Bruce's message touches the congregation and brings greater meaning to the scriptures. We pray that today's message lifts the hearts of the congregation and that we will be moved by it throughout the week ahead. It is by your grace that we go out and serve one another. In God's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay, bye. Jesus. They want me to pray in church on Sunday. We gotta practice. It's gotta sound good, Jesus. No, it's gotta sound great. This is my one shot. I've gotta inspire them. I've gotta impress them.
Let's pray.
It's a lot harder than it looks.
Shall we pray?
Sure.
Let's try faster.
Eyes open or eyes closed? Eyes closed, I pass out. Eyes open, I throw up.
Our Father, what in heaven?
Forgive us sinners. Prepare us for the end times.
Father God, just show us, Father God, all the Father God ways, Father God, that Father God, you, Father God, our Father God with us.
Now is part where we play music during the prayer.
And now we pause for a moment to confess our sins. And moving right along.
Is that too fast?
We pray that you would save us from the communists and socialists and terrorists. And Al Qaeda.
You'll all join me and turn to the prayer on the screen.
Good golly, it is hot in here.
Working in warm-ups. Thank you, God, for the three chords that I know, so I can play every worship song ever.
Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us.
God, you are a gnarly God.
Oh, gosh.
Your ways are as mysterious as a giant wave.
Father God, Holy Spirit, Son of God, Jesus, Father God.
Glory forever and ever.
Because God, you are sick.
And ever. Amen.
Amen. Feedback time. I think I nailed it.
Well, as Michelle has already proven, it's not that difficult to be able to pray in front of people, even in front of the Lord. We're glad you're here. Welcome to Imagine Church this morning. Whoever you are and wherever you are in your faith journey, there's always a place for you here with us. And if we can ever be of help to you or minister to you in any way, please call upon us. We'd be honored to serve you in ways that we can. This is a busy weekend. We might try without this for a while. This is a busy weekend for a lot of our folks. We have folks in Florida today, in Hawaii today, but you're here, and we're grateful that you're here. Thanks for your faithfulness before the Lord and for being here with us in worship this morning. Let's bow our heads and pray together. We know in beauty and in mystery we see the face of God. In the common and in the ordinary, we know the love of Christ. In the bread and in the cup, we taste the presence of God. In the song and in the embrace, we share the joy of our faith. Almighty God, we remember that our Lord Jesus Christ prayed that all of his followers might be one. As we worship you today, make us mindful of all of our brothers and sisters everywhere. Keep us from the temptation to think that we have a franchise on the truth and that our way is the only way. But stir up the brotherly love for one another, that we may indeed fulfill the prayer of our blessed Lord. And all this we pray for the sake of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, You shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, You have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Today we're beginning a brand new series that's called Living with Limits. And what we're going to do in these next 5 weeks is to take an in-depth look at really God's rules and laws, and why God established rules. And they're by a familiar name that all of you know. It's called the Ten Commandments. Based on a book by Dr. Ron Mell that I read just a short while ago, and based on what we find in Scripture from Exodus in chapter 20. I look forward to sharing this series with you over these next few weeks, and thank you for your presence here over these 5 Sundays as we continue this through the first Sunday of June. I want to ask Andrea Gunner, she'll come and share just a brief word about what's happening with our Imagination Youth, because her husband Tim is actually in our Imagine Kids group as one of our small group leaders today. Andrea, thank you so much.
Good morning. Just a quick announcement. We're having youth group this evening. It's going to be at 4:30. We're going to do something different today, and we're going to meet at River Hills River Point Park. We're going to play some volleyball, roast some marshmallows. So if your teens are here today, teens, are y'all paying attention up there? Hello? That's right. Mama's up here now. Okay, good. Just making sure. So we're going to get together and have youth group do a devotion. So we'd love to have you. If your children aren't here today, if you'll just remind them, if they have friends that want to come, we welcome them as always, but bring your volleyball playing shoes. We're going to roast some marshmallows, and we're going to meet and River Hills. The Phillips have offered their home, 78 Honeysuckle Woods Drive, and if you have any questions about how to get there, just see me after church. We'd love to have all of our youth join us together. We're nearing the end of the season. We're going to be doing some things differently for youth group. So if you'll come out and join us tonight, we would love to have all of our rising sixth graders all the way up through 12th grade this evening. Real quick, today after church, we are going to have a quick meeting about our summer camp that we're doing in Lake Junaluxa. So we'd love to have you be a part of the meeting. If you're just slightly interested, please come. No more than 10 minutes, just a quick meeting. And then also, we're getting ready to prepare to go to Rock the Park. If you're interested in that, I need to know, like, we're going to order those tickets probably in the next week to see if you get that. So if you're interested, see me after church. We're going to have a meeting about all those things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrea. Where are you all meeting after church? Okay. All right. Youth meeting be here. And in room 122 right after church, Tyra wanted me to announce that all of the parents of our Imagine Kids who are going to Centra Kid Camp in June, she's having a meeting with you today in 122. And so most of you will not be going out those doors right after worship. You'll be either staying in here if you're a parent of teenager, or you'll be going down to 122 if you're a parent of Imagine Kids. We look forward to those.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and the red eyes, I can barely see. When I realize I've been sold out by my friends and my family, I can hear the rain reminding me, in the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see a future, a picture, slowly fade away. And when the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the test comes in and the doctor says I've only got a few months left, it's like a bitter pill I'm swallowing, I can barely take a breath. And when addiction steals my baby girl and there's nothing I can do, my only hope is to trust in you. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Well, when God delivered the Ten Commandments to Moses, God really sent the world a message. I mean, he sent the world the clearest picture, the most, I don't know how you could miss it, message. And the message was this. You don't ever, you can't ever, you won't ever find acceptance with God through your behavior. Ever. We all believe that's the case. And it's kind of buried in all these pockets of our religious thinking and our religious culture. Because there's a widespread assumption in all world religions, and just in the world, with people, that in order to find credibility with God, and in order to find acceptance with God, then somehow we've got to behave ourselves and perform our way into God's good graces. When you finally drill down and get right down to it, we all kind of believe that there's a good God and bad people, and we've got to get better in order for God to accept us and love us and for us to have credibility with God. Where did the idea come from, do you think? That God is good and we are bad, and so in order to get favor with God or to get God to answer your prayer, we have to behave ourselves and be good and obey the law and clean up our act. That by doing better and by keeping rules or laws, we gain credibility or acceptance with God. But you know what's really interesting? If God has ever sent the world a message, the message is the opposite of that. And the message is this, that God's rules and God's laws are not a condition for a relationship, they are confirmation of a relationship. The rules and laws of God are not a condition of His love, it's confirmation of His love. And the story has been misused and twisted to support the whole notion of, well, God's got a bunch of rules and laws, and He sort of threw them out there, and He's standing back with His arms folded going, all right, y'all take a shot. Let's see how you do. I only gave you 10. Go ahead, let's see how you do. And we're thinking, well, there are 10. I don't remember really but a few of them. Oh, yeah, thou shalt not murder. Well, I haven't done that. But this is a pretty high standard. And God says, well, don't worry, you're in. Thou shalt not steal. Well, I haven't done a lot of that. Haven't committed adultery. Then Jesus came along and said, well, even if you think about it, you're guilty. Well, then, God, never mind. I mean, that doesn't seem fair. You can't even think about it. But there's this whole idea that God kind of threw out the laws and the commandments. Then Jesus came along and jacked them up way beyond anything we could imagine. And God's up there going, well, y'all just do the best you can. And when you die, you and I will talk about it and we'll just see how you did. And all of that stems from this incredible moment in history when God broke the silence. I'm telling you, this is an amazing story. When God broke the silence and said, I'm going to give you some rules and laws to live by. Buried in the story of the Ten Commandments. Buried in the story of the Ten Commandments is the secret of the relationship between God's love and God's law. In this story is the secret to the relationship between having a relationship with God and the rules of God. And right out there on the bottom shelf is this simple rule for all of us to discover that God sent early on. I mean, early on in human history, 1300 and something B.C., God wanted to make it clear, and here's the secret. You don't perform and behave your way into my good graces. God says, my law and my rules, they're not a condition for a relationship. They're confirmation of a relationship that already exists. During this series, over 5 Sundays, we're going to have an opportunity to look at God's rules. And buried in these rules is the secret to God's character. We get to discover what's important to God. Because you see, your rules tell you what's important to you. My rules will tell you what's important to me. As an example, my father had only a few rules in our house when I was growing up. But one of them was, you shall respect your mother. Rules are values. And so we get to discover what is valuable to God. Now, 3 months before God gave His law to Moses, and Moses is up on a mountain on Mount Sinai, and the children of Israel are all down in the valley below. Let me kind of give you the context of this. The nation of Israel had been in slavery for about 400 years. Now, that's hard for us to get our arms around that. 400 years, that's longer than the United States of America has been in existence. Their entire history, when they went to elementary school and studied history, the entire history of the nation was just slavery. That's all they could study. They had no history before slavery. There was none. There was a man named Abraham who had a son named Isaac, who had a son named Jacob, and Jacob had 12 sons, and they had families. And they all moved to Egypt as free people. But they were not a nation. They were just this big, supersized family. And over time, they became an even bigger family. And then Egypt enslaved the family and made them slaves. And then they grew up and became a nation. But their entire history as a nation was slavery. That's it. They didn't need laws. They were slaves. All they knew was slavery. And God had been very quiet for 400 years. And then finally, God brought them to this mountain and was about to give them their law. They didn't have any laws. They didn't have any society. They had nothing except for one thing. They had a God who all of a sudden had begun to act on their behalf. A God who had begun to speak through Moses to the people. A God who 3 months earlier had made a mockery of every deity, every aspect of Egyptian culture, and led the nation of Israel out of Egypt, out of bondage, out of slavery. And the Israelites thought, this is unbelievable. Somebody is speaking on our behalf. Somebody has come to our rescue. We don't even know his name, or her name, or its name. We know nothing about this God, but good grief, we have an advocate. We have somebody who's come along beside us. This is unbelievable. And finally, when the Egyptian economy was in shambles, Moses said, okay, Pharaoh, are you going to let us go? And Pharaoh said, no, you can't go. And Moses said, okay, this is the last straw. And in that moment, God issued his first command to the nation of Israel. And it wasn't on Mount Sinai. This was when they were still in Egypt. And listen to what God said to the people. God said, slaughter a goat or lamb to feed your family. But take some of the blood and put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. And the people of Israel all went, do what? Yes. God has issued a thou shalt. Thou shalt take the blood of the lambs or the goat, and you're to put it on the top of the doors and the sides of your doors. That's really odd, isn't it? And in Exodus 12, verse 12, we read this. And on that very same night, God said, I will pass through Egypt, and I will strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt, for I am the Lord. And if you wonder why Jewish people call it Passover, here it is. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will strike you when I strike Egypt. And then verse 14. This is a day you are to commemorate, for the generations to come after you will celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance. And here's what God is saying to the nation. This is so important for you and me. He's saying, look, let me tell you what I want to be for you. Not your lawgiver. I want to be your Savior. I want to be your rescuer. I want to come right down to your point of greatest need, and I want to be your deliverer. And all I need you to do is to have faith in me and to trust me. I want to be your God, and I want you to trust me. And standing on the top of Mount Sinai, about to receive God's commandments, with that memory just 3 months old, here's what the nation of Israel knew. And here's what Moses knew. We're not here to get in with God. We're here because we're already in. We're not here to establish a relationship. Good grief, we've got one. We're not here to find out, is he really going to be our God? Clearly he is. He delivered us from our captors and we hadn't even done a thing. We didn't even know the rules. We didn't even know his name. We knew nothing. We had nothing. He just decided for some reason that we don't completely understand to release us from our captors and to bring us to this mountain. And now he's about to give us the law that we are to live by. You see, right there in the giving and the receiving of the Ten Commandments is the greatest message that you will ever hear as a human being. That a relationship with God is not predicated on your keeping the rules. He established a relationship with people before they even ever knew what the rules were. A relationship with God isn't based around rule keeping and law keeping. Because he illustrated for the whole world, I have chosen for myself a people. Not because of what they've done or how they've performed, but simply because they trusted me. They did one unusual, unique thing as evidence of their trust in me. And that's all it took to establish and initiate the relationship of trust. And now that relationship has been sealed. Now I'm going to give you the law that I want you to live by. That's the message of the Ten Commandments. That's the message of the Old Testament. And folks, that's also the message of the New Testament. It's the same message that Jesus conveyed to his followers during their last meal together. 1400 and something years later, when they were celebrating, guess what? The Passover. And Jesus is pouring the wine that represented the blood of the lamb that they put over the doorpost. And Jesus is breaking the bread that represented the unleavened bread that they ate right before they escaped from Egypt. And then he said this. He said, guys, it's different tonight. Tonight the wine doesn't represent the blood of the lamb that we've celebrated all these hundreds of years, because God is about to do something really different. From now on, this wine represents my blood. It's about to be spilled, not just for a nation, but for the whole world. And this bread doesn't represent the bread that they ate that night right before they escaped from Egypt. Tonight, this bread represents my body. But some hours from now is going to be broken, not for the nation, but for the whole world. And when I'm gone, I want you to go out all over the whole world. And I want you to tell people that the Heavenly Father has invited them in to an unconditional relationship of love and grace, not based on anything they do, but based on something that has been done for them. Because before the beginning of time, Jesus said, that's the kind of God my Heavenly Father is and will always be. And if God ever compliments you with a rule, it's just evidence that you're already in. It's never a condition of acceptance. I want you to watch this. By you.
that carries me each day and surrounds me. Lord, all I want to say is I look forward to the day I can see your face. So I lay myself down, and in your rest I now am found inside you. Covered by your love, covered by your blood, covered by your righteousness. Covered by your love, covered by your blood, covered by your righteousness. I'm covered. I'm covered. I'm covered by you.
I want to give you kind of a silly illustration as this introduction to our series, and then we're going to have communion. If you're a pet owner and you have a fence, whose dog do you keep in your fence? Your dog, right? And you see, you put your dog in your fence. Did your dog become your dog when you put it in the fence? I mean, putting it in the fence, did that make it your dog? Wasn't my dog till I put it in the fence. Became my dog. My dog ran off. Wasn't my dog anymore. People down the street called me, said, found your dog. I said, it's not my dog. It's got your phone number on its collar. Not my dog. See, what made it my dog, it was in my fence. Got out of my fence. Not my dog. Ownership is all about being in the fence. No. You know when the dog became your dog? When you purchased it. The reason you put it in the fence is because it was already yours. It already belonged to you. Some years ago, I got home one night, and Tyra met me at the door in tears. She said, Bruce, Mindy's missing. Mindy was her favorite little miniature black schnauzer, her little daughter with fur. And I've been meaning to get invisible fence, which is, you know, invisible fence is kind of like God's law, you know. I mean, when you bump up against it, ow, what was that? Wouldn't it be great, really, if life worked that way? And you get that call, wouldn't you like to come over and have a few drinks? You say, no, I'm not coming over, because if I came over, I'd get shocked. We'd all be better Christians, wouldn't we, if God's law was like invisible fence? But anyway, Mindy's gone, and Tyra's frantic. She said, you've got to go find her. And I said, well, I'm tired. And she said, she's gone. She's missing. You've got to go find her. And I said, she's going to come home. She said, no, Bruce, you got to go look for her. So what did I do? I said, well, if Mindy's not in our yard, she's not our dog anymore. I mean, just get over it. She doesn't belong to us anymore. She belongs to whosoever yard she's in. That's how it works. Because if she's in the fence, no. She bought none of that. So this really is kind of a biblical thing, what I did then. I put my tennis shoes on and I went out searching for the dog. Why? Because the dog is ours. The dog's lost. There were these woods behind our house. And I figured maybe she'd gotten lost out there somehow. So I'm up there in the woods looking for it. It's pitch black dark. Ended up on this gravel road that's on the other side of the woods and ended up in somebody's driveway accidentally. I'm searching for this dog because I can't go home without this dog because it's our dog. And I searched and searched for over an hour. And I never found Mindy. She was asleep under our bed in our room the whole time. And the analogy ends there. So you put those Kleenexes away, Mindy was safe at home. But here's the deal. Here's the deal. The moral of the story is this. God doesn't want you running around in the woods. No, that's not it. here's the moral of the story, and this is a change in our thinking for many of us. God has given us rules and commandments because God loves us, not for us to prove something to God. God has given us rules and commandments because we're already in, not as a means of our getting in. Let me just say this. If you're one of those people who have thought, I'd love to be in with God, I'd love to know that I had a one-on-one thing with God, I'd love to have this relationship that I keep hearing about, but look at my life. How could I ever be in with God? I've got some great news for you. You don't have to look at your life anymore. God accepted an entire nation of slaves who had done nothing right because they didn't even know what was wrong. They didn't even know what was right. And in the same way, when Jesus died on the cross, He died for all your sins, which means He assumed that you would be a sinner, which means He assumed that you would get it wrong. He didn't die on the cross so that you could get it right. He died on the cross because He knew that you would get it wrong. And so He says to you, I want you to be mine, and I want to be your God, and I want to be your personal Savior. But I just need you to do what the nation of Israel did some 3,500 years ago. I need you to trust Me. I don't need you to walk under a door with the blood of bulls and goats and lambs. I need you to simply place your faith in the blood of My Son, God says, who died once and for all for your sin. And if you do that, you're in. You're in. You know, there are a lot of people out there who have it all wrong. And the reason they have it all wrong is because people like me got it all wrong for you. And preachers and churches and religions and organizations get it all flip-flopped. Because it's a lot easier to control people if you say you have to behave a certain way or you won't get to heaven when you die. That's a lot of leverage. It's a lie, but it's a lot of leverage. But it doesn't work, but it's a lot of leverage. And it has sent more people away from God than anything else that I can name. But the message of the Old and New Testament is that God has invited you into a relationship of unconditional love based on nothing you do, but on something that He has done on your behalf. And just as He delivered the nation of Israel with the blood of sheep and goats, He has delivered you. He has delivered you through the blood of His Son. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, up until this time, we thought it was all about what we did. We thought it was all about cleaning up our act. We thought it was about keeping a rule or a law. We thought it was about being a good person. But today, maybe for the first time, we realize it's about what You did, not what we've done. And so today, O God, we're placing our faith in Your Son's death on the cross as full payment for our sins. And You are our God. We want to know in our hearts that we are Your children. So thank You for forgiving us of our sin. And we're relying on Jesus, not on ourselves, to be our Savior. So God, thank You. Thank You, thank You for making it that simple and that clear in the world we live in. Because we're so surrounded by such confusion when it comes to who You are and Your love for us. And as we introduce this new series today, O God, we just thank You that Your rules aren't a condition. They're a confirmation. And we thank You for that. In Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite Gregory to join me here at the table. And also our lay reader today, Michelle, if she'll come and join us, and newly ordained Reverend David White. David, will you come and join us as well? You ever realized what an amazing connection there is between the Passover that Jesus and his disciples celebrated together and observed that night and the Last Supper that we celebrate and observe this morning? In ancient Jewish tradition, the Passover was made known through the blood of the lambs that was over their doorposts and on the door frames. And when God came that night to teach an awful lesson to the Egyptians and to the Egyptian culture, he passed over those houses that were covered by that blood, the blood of the lamb. In the same way, the blood of the sacrificial lamb of Jesus Christ is what covers you and me. It's not out of anything that we've done. It's out of something that was done for us, that God made his love known for us in such a real and dramatic and life-changing way. What you have heard this morning is just kind of maybe a strange introduction to a set of rules and laws that God gave us not to bring about anything, but just to confirm what God's already done. And that is, God has accepted us, and we're his. And just as your parents, when you were growing up, gave you rules and laws and guidelines, they did so out of their love for you because they wanted to shape you into the kind of person that they knew that you needed to be. And that's what God has done and God is doing for us. The only reason we have laws and rules are to shape us into the kind of people that God wants us to be. So that's what we're going to study together and learn from over these weeks. But there's no better way for us to begin this time of worship over these 5 weeks than to join together here at this table, just as the disciples did with Jesus on that night so long ago. And near the end of the meal, Jesus turned to them and he said, "Is there anything left of that bread, that loaf? Pass it here." And so Jesus took bread, and after he had given thanks to God, he broke it and he distributed it to them, and he said, "Take and eat. This is no longer the Passover unleavened bread, commemorating what was done long ago. This is my body, which is given for you." Then after the meal, he said, "Is there anything left in that goblet? Pass it here." And he took the cup, and after he had given thanks to God, he passed it to each of them. And he said, "This is not the blood that we recall from Passover. This is my blood of a new covenant, a brand new covenant that is made in my blood, made for you, between you and God, to set you right with God." And when he said that, the disciples, I'm sure, remembered that verse in Jeremiah, where the prophet said, speaking for God, "The day is coming, God said, when I will make unto you a new covenant, not like the old covenant I made with your ancestors when I led them out of Egypt, but a new covenant made in my sacrifice for you." All of a sudden, if they didn't realize then who this was, they realized this is the Messiah. This is the Son of God. The same Messiah, the same Son of God, whose presence is here with us through the mystery and through the majesty of his Holy Spirit. Let's pray together. Loving God, we do not come to this table trusting in our own righteousness and goodness. For if that were the case, who could stand? It's not anything we've done, because consistently we tend to get it wrong. It's all about something that has been done for us. And in that great act of sacrifice and redemption and reclamation, we were set right enough with you, O God, that you invited us into a relationship. A relationship that is intimate, that is one-on-one, that is personal, with none other than the Creator of the universe, our Heavenly Father. And for that, O God, we give you humble thanks today. I pray that you'll be in the heart, in the soul of each person who comes to receive the bread and cup of communion today, just as a reminder that we are yours, that you have purchased us, you've claimed us. You put a fence around us because you want us to live with limits, because we're yours. And that's what a loving parent does with his prized possession, and that is his children. So we thank you for this holy act of worship. And we pray this with thanksgiving in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Going to commune by intinction. Most of you know how we do this. We'll have two lines that will come down the center row. We'll have two stations, one on each side. And you'll receive a piece of bread from the common loaf. And the posture is simply open hands, which symbolizes an open heart, an open spirit. And as you receive the bread, just dip it in the chalice, the common chalice, and then commune, and make your way back to your seats by the side aisles. And those in the balcony, we'll invite you to come down and join us, and we'll ask the praise team in just a few moments to commune first. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for it is one loaf of which we all partake. Is not the breaking of the bread a means of sharing in the body of Christ? Is not the cup over which we give thanks a means of sharing in the blood of Christ? Michelle, my sister, this is the body of Christ given out of love for you. Gregory, my brother, of his great love, this is the body of Christ given for you. David, my brother, of his great love, this is the body of Christ given for you. And Michelle, my sister, this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Gregory, my brother, the blood of Christ shed for you. David, my brother, the blood of Christ shed for you. And we invite you now to come.
Is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, in pride or shame, but in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him. We fade and die, fame, youth, beauty hurry by, but life eternal calls to us at the cross. I will not boast in wealth or might or human wisdom fleeting. But I will boast in knowing Christ at the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer,
to wonders here that I confess my worth and my unworthiness, my value fixed, my ransom paid at the cross. I will rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone. I will trust in my Redeemer, my soul is satisfied in him alone.
Was that, oh, I have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And you stressed that so much. And I just want to thank you for reminding us of that. That was great. It's now time for our offering. So would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your words that you spoke through Pastor Bruce. We thank you for reminding us that you're interested in a relationship with us. You're interested in us being your children. We thank you for that. And you did that through your son that you gave up for us. You sent him on a rescue mission, and we thank you for that. Lord, now as we have this opportunity to give back to you, Lord, please be with the giver and be with all who are here. Work in their hearts so they will feel your presence and the desire that you have to be in relationship with them. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, and we all together said, amen. My soul, what can
still a mystery each day.
Powerful video. Thank you, Bruce. Let's stand this morning. Thank you to the praise team. Thank you to Pastor Bruce and all of our leadership. But thank you to you all for coming every Sunday and being so faithful. Because I'm telling you what, we are stronger together. We are stronger. And I say this, look to the right, to your left, behind you and in front of you. We are one body and we are strong. And we will wait upon the Lord. And I love us because we do. And we will do what He asks us to do. And we'll go forward in light and love. Sing together.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, God,
you reign forever.
We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
A strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God,
you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer.
I like it over here.
You are the
I want to recognize today. She went through a long recovery after a bad fall and a broken pelvis, but last Sunday and today, Ann Rother is back with us. Ann, raise your hand. We just want to tell you how glad we are to have you back with us in worship today. We're so glad you're here. And also someone else we want to congratulate. It was my privilege to be a part of a grand service of ordination here in this chapel a couple of weeks ago when 7 different people were ordained or licensed into various forms of Christian ministry, one of which was our own David White, and he is here today with his wife Angie. David, we want to congratulate you on this high moment in your life. We're proud of you. He just said to me just a few minutes ago during worship, he said, it's hard to believe it's been 2 years. It has been a fast 2 years that Gregory Roberts has been with us as our ministerial intern. Hate to think that's coming to an end, but God has some great things in store for Gregory, and we look forward to being a part of that, but he'll always be a part of the Imagine Church family, and that's Gregory Roberts, who's been our ministerial intern. We're proud of you, Gregory. And you know, the Imagine Church crowd, it doesn't take much for us to want to have a party. So we're going to have a party at the end of worship on the 21st to recognize Gregory. We look forward to that as we have a reception in his honor, his last Sunday with us, the day after he graduates. He graduates from here on May 20th. If you're an Imagination Youth parent, stay in here. If you're an Imagine Kids parent and your child's going to Centra Kid Camp, please go down to 122. It is just down the hallway to your right where we have the Easter lunch. You'll find Miss Tyra there and some of her helpers to help with that. Next Sunday is one of those really special days. We're going to really kind of get into our series, Living with Limits. But it's also Mother's Day, and we do something really special on Mother's Day. We honor and recognize each mom or each woman, because even without children, you have been like a mother to someone. And so we have an individual blessing for you, along with a couple gifts and a carnation from Imagine Church. So please be here. Bring your mother with you. As I said last week, if you can't, find somebody who looks like a mom and just bring her in with you, because we have a lot of gifts we want to give out next Sunday. It'll be indeed a special day. We look forward to a grand time of worship next Sunday on May 14th. Let's pray together. Gracious Lord, we thank you for our time of worship today. We thank you that we feel your presence through the power of your Holy Spirit anytime we gather in this holy place. But it's not just the place, oh God, it's the gathering of Christ's followers that become the body of Christ. We're a part of that, and we're just so honored and humbled to think that you would use even the likes of us to accomplish your holy purpose in the world. We thank you, oh God, for what you're doing in and through us, for the privilege we have of being a part of this grand and glorious enterprise that you call the Church of Jesus Christ on earth. And we get to play a part in that. We're the ones who are on the center stage right now. We know that we have cheering on us those saints who have gone before us. And we're ushering in those who will come after us. But right now, oh God, we know that the continuation of the faith depends upon how we embrace what you've given us and then impart it with others. Help us always to realize that evangelism, that the growth of this Christian movement, is always an individual matter. It's always up to us to be able to extend this to others. And so I pray this week that each one of our people here will just find one other person that they can speak a word to, a word of grace, a word of redemption, a word of hope, a word of mercy, a word of peace, that might make a difference, perhaps even an eternal difference in that person's life. And then invite them to come and be a part of this with them next week. We look forward to the way that you will continue to work within us. Thank you for what you've done in the past, for what you're doing now, and for the promise in your grace of what is yet to be. Would you now say this after me? Lord Jesus, we love you, and we go now to serve you. Amen.
Thank you.